Hello everybody, welcome back to my vlog, which this week is going to cover plantar fasciitis. I can hear you all saying, what on earth is plantar fasciitis? But I can assure you, if you've had it, you'll know. And maybe you have it and don't know the name of it, but you are in pain and wondering. So hopefully I can put everything to rest here today. So, what is it? It's persistent pain. Focus on the underside of the foot, particularly in the heel, that actually gets to the point where you can almost do no walking at all and therefore interferes dramatically with day-to-day life. It affects the plantar fascia, which is a band of tissue, a ligament, which stretches all the way from the toes to the back of the heel. So it goes along the whole underside of the foot. It supports the arch of the foot, so it's a very important ligament. The pain that you get with plantar fasciitis is caused by chronic, so long-term degeneration and repair that then makes the fascia tight and causes pain. So who gets it? Well, lots of people get it. There's a 10% lifetime chance that you'll get it. And it causes 80% of all heel pain. So as a GP, if we're dealing with heel pain, the chances that it's plantar fasciitis is really high. It's most common in people aged 40 to 60, but that doesn't mean you can't get it outside of those ages, and we do see it in young people. Young people that are standing all of the time, running, or just on their feet, up and down with their job. So athletes, soldiers, shop workers, for example, do tend to suffer younger than that 40 to 60 age range. So what are the causes? Well, having a high arch or even flat feet, so the two opposites, can be a cause. Excessive pronation, so some people when they walk or when they run actually roll their feet inwards, and that can put you at risk of plantar fasciitis because it's doing damage all of the time, which is then being repaired. So it's really important that you have good shoes, and if you're a runner, go to a shop where they look at your gait on a treadmill and get some shoes to stop pronation. Walking, standing or being on your feet for long periods of time can be a cause. Being overweight can be a cause. Having poorly fitted shoes can also cause it. And having a tight Achilles tendon, which is the tendon that runs at the back of your heel and into your calf muscle, or having tight calf muscles can also cause it. So it's really important that if you do exercise or run, you really stretch out before you exercise and warm down afterwards to make sure that you're not exacerbating that tightness in the Achilles or in your calf. So what are the symptoms? Well, initially, the onset of pain in the underside of the heel, which can be quite insidious, just come on slowly day by day, but gradually getting worse. Having intense pain in the first few minutes when you get up in the morning in that underside of the heel area that gets better once you stop moving around and walking is a really common sign. But then the pain actually getting worse as the day goes on and you're on your feet and walking or running. So how do we diagnose it? Well, it's a clinical diagnosis that can be done quite simply at your GP. And initially, we take a really good history from you to find out what you've been doing, and we'd assess your risks to see what your risk factors were for plantar fasciitis. We would examine you, and we'd have a prod around under the foot, palpation, and quite often you'll be tender in a certain area under the foot. And I'm going to put a link to a picture of where the most common site of pain is for plantar fasciitis. But it isn't limited to that one spot. It can be over quite a vast area along the sole of the foot. We look at the way that you walk, your gait, and that can quite often be abnormal as you try and prevent the pain. So that can be an abnormal gait, or you can be limping. You might have what we call limited ankle dorsiflexion. So that's when you pull your foot up and your ankle move so that your foot can actually come up towards your body. That can actually be limited in plantar fasciitis. And you might have something called a positive windlass test. And this is where we would extend your big toe upwards towards your nose, and that would replicate the pain on the underside of the foot. So it's quite easy for us in GP to make a diagnosis of plantar fasciitis. We have to always have in our mind that it could be various other things, and it could be lots of other things. So it could be a fracture of your calcaneal bone, so the bone in your heel bone. It could be Achilles tendonitis with the pain radiating to the sole of the foot. Your fat pads, which are the pads in the sole of your feet that protect you against damage, can atrophy over time, so they can shrink. That can cause pain. You can have bursitis under the heel bone. You can have peripheral neuropathy. So for example, people with diabetes are more at risk of that, where the nerves in your feet are actually starting to burn and be painful. The actual plantar fascia can rupture, and that can cause pain. So that's a complete tear in the ligament. Your nerves can be trapped, so nerve entrapment. Didn't say that very well, did I? Nerve entrapment. And very, very rarely, and I can't stress how rare this is, it can be malignancy. So what are the treatments for plantar fasciitis? So initially we recommend self-care, and I'll talk you through that. After that, structured physiotherapy or podiatry. After that, corticosteroid injections. And then finally, an orthopaedic surgeon referral if none of those things are working. So in terms of self-care, the reason we start here is that within 6 months, most people undergoing a series of self-care processes will actually get better. So the kind of things we recommend is that you avoid long walks or standing. So it is restrictive, I'm afraid, especially if you're somebody who has a job where you're standing or you like to go for walks. Good shoes with strong arch support are really important, and cushioned soles. Avoid walking barefoot is really important. You need support and protection for the sole of the foot. Buy yourself some insoles and heel pads. There's no evidence that having them custom made is any better than buying them in any good chemist, shoe shop or shoe repair shop. Use painkillers like ibuprofen, so NSAIDs, that's the first recommendation. But if you can't take NSAIDs, and lots of people can't, then use paracetamol and codeine. Lose weight if you're overweight, because that will help. You can use ice packs for 15 to 20 minutes when it's really bad to just help with the pain and just give you some symptom relief. And self-physiotherapy, so special exercises designed for the plantar fascia. And I'm going to put a link to those in the comments afterwards so that you have those. So structured physiotherapy or podiatry, why is this important? Well, you can get a proper assessment and they can look at all of the risk factors that we've talked about earlier. So a physiotherapist or podiatrist can do some deep tissue manipulation and massage, which often really helps. They can actually do an ultrasound treatment. So not the ultrasound where we take pictures, for example, of pregnant women, but an ultrasound that passes into the tissue and helps repair it. So that's often very useful. They can teach you to offload so that you're not putting a strain when you walk on the fascia. And they can also take you through the self-care exercises so that you know you're doing them properly and they can assess the way that you're doing them. So it is often quite an important part of the treatment plan. Then the corticosteroid injections, and the jury's out on this one because there are some benefits, but there are also quite a few risks. So we do this really if nothing else is working, or sometimes we do it in the 6 month period to give you some relief while you do the self-care exercises. But it is a very short-term relief. So the injection itself is really painful, and I mean really painful. And you then get some post-injection pain that can last for 3 to 4 days. And that pain is much more painful than the plantar fasciitis itself. You generally only get about a month of relief from the symptoms. Some people get longer, but quite often it is just a month. So it's a short-term gain for quite a lot of pain. It can cause fat pad atrophy, so you might be replacing one problem with another. So as I've said before, the fat pads under the feet, which are there to protect them, can actually shrink with the steroid injection, and that can actually cause pain. And it can cause plantar fascia rupture, so a tear in that fascia, which is also very painful. So you need to consider the risk of those things. If you are going to have it done, it's worth always having it done under ultrasound guidance, to make sure it goes into the right place, and this is best practice. And also, if you're needing more than one of these, you can actually only have it repeated once, and it must be at least 6 weeks since you've had the last one. So after that, if nothing's helping, not the self-care, the physio, or the corticosteroid injection, we can refer you to an orthopaedic surgeon. And they have several tools at their disposal that we don't have. So they have extracorporeal shockwave therapy. And this is non-invasive and what happens is they pass an acoustic wave, shock wave, through the area into the fascia, which causes micro damage. So tiny little areas of damage, which then get repaired and improves the situation in terms of the pain that you're having. It also has a direct effect on the nerve endings, and it reduces their sensitivity to pain, so that's why it helps reduce the pain. You might need several sessions, and the important thing to know is that the evidence for this being effective is actually quite patchy, so it's not always available on the NHS, so you need to check in your area, and if it isn't, you'd have to have it done privately. As a last resort, there's surgery, and this is plantar fascia release. And it's known to be effective and to be helpful, but obviously we're further down the line because of the risks of surgery, and it always would be a last resort. So those are the things that the orthopaedic surgeons can offer. So as always, I've looked at some other solutions for you to see if there's anything else that might be added to what we do within the NHS or within the medical arena. So custom-made orthotics, a lot of people swear by them, and although there's no evidence to suggest that they're any better than the ones you buy over the counter, they do fit your feet exactly. They are very expensive, but I know that I have some patients who say they're just more comfortable to wear. Taping does help, so this can be done by a physiotherapist or a podiatrist, and this is where the strain is taken off the plantar fascia by special tapes which keep the foot in certain positions. And you would have seen the sportsmen with their knees and elbows and shoulders all taped up. It's the same kind of thing. It's providing support in the right areas so that then other areas of the foot are not under strain. So that can work as well. Night splints are sometimes suggested. So you have your foot in a special splint overnight. There's actually no evidence that these work. They're actually very uncomfortable to wear, and they can disturb sleep. So you're then adding to your problems by being tired and possibly grumpy because you're in pain and you're not sleeping. There is some evidence for Botox emerging. So Botox is injected into the plantar fascia to relax it. And whilst I couldn't find a lot of evidence for this, there are some places doing it. So I will put some information in the notes afterwards so that you can investigate it for yourself. There's also some evidence for platelet-rich plasma, or PRP. Now, we are using this in medicine for lots of different joints, knees, for example, to actually promote healing. And we take a blood sample, your own blood, spin it in a special machine so that we then take out the platelets in plasma, and it's really rich and concentrated. And we then pop it back into the foot, into the plantar fascia, where the aim is to promote healing much faster than your body would automatically do it. So I will put some links to that afterwards as well, because it does seem quite promising and does work in other areas. So that's the lowdown on plantar fasciitis. We all have a 10% lifetime risk of getting it. It is really, really painful and accounts for 80% of all heel pain. It can interfere with life to the point where you can no longer carry out your normal activities. And that's why it's important that we get on top of it, because people that can't do the things that they like to do get depressed, they put on weight, and everything spirals from there. So getting on top of it quickly is really important. And if we do that, we know that with self-care, most people will get better within 6 months. So I have put those exercises in the link afterwards so that you can have a look at that. If you don't have a diagnosis but you do have heel pain, please pop along to your GP to get a formal diagnosis, because once you're on that pathway, the end is in sight in terms of getting it resolved for you. But obviously, if you don't know what it is, then you may not be doing the right thing. So again, as always, pop along to your GP. It's a quick and easy consult, and you can get on the pathway to treatment. If I've missed anything or you have any questions, do pop it in the comments afterwards. I'm always happy to answer and take suggestions for future vlogs. So as always, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you very soon.